battle has been multi-generational. This is my message for the corporation. Don't use Cromwell's history for decoration. Nike can have an outlet to sell some shoes. Why can't the kids around the corner have an outlet too? Hip and funky bars, but no monkey bars. There's an organic store that people can't afford in their backyard. They trying to change Ivy City. The writing is on the wall, but let's make it graffiti. We make the struggle look so pretty. You can almost forget about the nitty gritty. We living on borrowed time and sacred land. If you choose to walk the path, you gotta take a stand. Y'all won't take these acres up off our hands. We're gonna keep fighting, man. What's your plan?
We got the legacy, Ivy City forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, DC will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, go, will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, Cromwell will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on.
Ivy City, that's my home, that's my fam. We gon' fight for a wreck as long as we can. Educate the brothers, let them know they powerful. Never let them break and show them you invaluable. I want all my homies off the streets. I'm tired of seeing my brother thugging, posted with the heat. They gotta sacrifice their freedom just to make ends meet. The youth don't got no space to play, so they use the streets. A strong mind they can never defeat. Unity is the key, Let's keep the peace. Better ways, better vibes, better thoughts. Less spending, more saving, bigger vault. We gotta reconnect and reinvest, so we can redirect the system. Had Cromwell for the children. That 2 acres, we gon' take that. And make it something impressive that they can't take back.
We got the legacy, Ivy City forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, DC will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, go, will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, Cromwell will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on.
Smoke house, ballin' churches, making trick plays. They can parlay, cause they Sundays ain't gun play. Yet they say that they care if I you say it. Why I young king still strapped up in the hallway. Forgotten city, never will we ever be. We are the legacy, Ivy City forever be. Standing strong, setting the stage for generations to come. It be the change and run how your community runs. It's time to open up Cromwell. And free ourselves from mental health. Cause it's sacred land for sacred play. And we ain't going nowhere. It's a sacred thing. Pushing on, pushing on. That money corruption made our faith stern. So strong. Watch it burn down.
Fire! We got the legacy, Ivy City forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We got the legacy, DC will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We are the legacy, go, will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on. We are the legacy, Cromwell will forever be. Pushing on, pushing on.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. We're happy to have you with us today on this spring equinox, first day of spring, and also Nowruz for many people around the world, New Year Day. So thank you for joining us. This is the monthly meeting of the DC Grassroots Planning Coalition. And my name is Parisa Nowruzi. I'm the director of Empower DC, and we're one of the groups that is helping to lead the coalition. I, along with our steering committee members, who maybe can put an indicator on their page so they can identify themselves with a wave or something right now. We welcome you and we thank you for being here again this month. I'm gonna quickly share with you what our agenda is. We have a number of people who are gonna share some updates with us. And then in the second half, we are gonna have a guest, Council Chairman Phil Mendelson. So we'll have to keep on our time. Continue to introduce yourself in the chat. Please let us know if you represent a specific organization, neighborhood, or ward. And also, if this is your first meeting with us, we have been meeting almost 4 years now. I think our first meeting was in April or May in 2017. And we've had over 1,200 folks from across the city participate. Many of you are regulars, and we welcome you to as you join us if you're new. So today we're going to give a couple quick background pieces of information, especially for the new folks. Then we have some hot topics that we're going to run through. We have a few presenters on topics, including the Council Office on Racial Equity's upcoming racial equity impact assessment. We have a couple of Ward 7 residents who are going to speak out about their concerns about the streetcar extension. We should learn a little bit about the new Inclusionary Zoning Plus program, and we're going to look at a snapshot of the history of Southwest and affordable housing and some PUDs, some planned unit developments that are on the table right now that perpetuate racial inequity in the community. Then we're going to welcome Council Chairman Phil Mendelson. He'll share some updates with us, and then we'll ask some questions. And at any point in the meeting, if you have questions, if you could put them in the chat, my colleague Paul Johnson will be watching the chat and will help us make sure that we get to those questions. Because we have a lot on the agenda, we'll try to keep everything brief, but there is a chance, you know, that we won't get to everything. So if so, we'll make sure to make space at our next meeting. And just very, very briefly, for those who are new, we are a citywide coalition of individuals and organizations who are committed to equitable community-led development. We want to stop the displacement of Black residents and communities in particular. We want to stop harmful development that harms communities through environmental injustice or other, other forms of harm. We are led by a steering committee. Many of our steering committee members are on the call right now. And that includes representatives of some organizations like the Washington Legal Clinic for the Homeless and People for Fairness and Southwest Voice, DC for Reasonable Development, but also a number of individuals. We have been, as I mentioned, meeting since 2017. We've participated in the full process of the comprehensive plan amendment cycle. We mobilized for the hearing back in March 2018. We also held study circles in all of the planning areas in the city, the 10 planning areas. We've continuously communicated with council offices and worked to strengthen policies in the comp plan around especially deeply affordable housing, family-sized housing, permanently affordable housing, and community leadership. And these are our guiding principles, which I won't go through in detail, but you can see that we're really committed to racial justice, to economic justice, and to environmental justice. Just for those who are brand new to the comp plan, it is a 1,000 plus page, 20-year guiding document. It guides development in the city. And one of the reasons why it is an important document is that the Zoning Commission, when it approves development, it must refer to the comprehensive plan, and per its statute, it is not to approve development that is not consistent with the comprehensive plan. So when the city makes changes to the comprehensive plan, it actually does have an outcome specifically when the Zoning Commission looks at development. We are in an amendment cycle. The plan was approved in 2006 and is actually slated for a full rewrite in 2026. But we've been in this amendment process for several years now. And part of our concern is that the underlying approach of the mayor's office and the Office of Planning throughout this process has really been to facilitate more of the type of development that we've seen over the last 20 years that led to the displacement of over 40,000 Black residents, and to really eliminate as much as possible community voice and opportunity for communities to appeal or to, you know, in any way shape development that's happening in their communities. That's why, okay, so then just quickly where we are now, there was a hearing back in November. Many of you may have attended. on the final changes to the comp plan. The council approved back in 2018 the changes to the first chapter of it, the framework, and now we're looking at the remaining chapters, which is, you know, over 1,000 pages. The hearings were already held, the public testimony was already held. And so now we're awaiting the what's called the markup. So there will be two meetings of the committee of the whole of the council, which is the entire council, led by Chairman Phil Mendelson, at which the first meeting they'll mark it up, literally make changes and have their first vote on it. And then they'll have a second and final vote on it. We had expected that to happen mid-March. It looks like it may be pushed to late March or early April. And we are expecting also that the newly created DC Council Office on Racial Equity will be releasing a racial equity impact assessment on the comp plan. And so we are expecting that to be a very significant document when it comes out. So we'll see how that also affects the process. You can look at our past meetings where we've gone into more depth in some of these topics on our YouTube page. And also, if you have not had a chance to look at what the Office of Planning is proposing in the amended comp plan, you should go to plandc.dc.gov. We created the Housing Justice Priorities document as our roadmap for what the main types of changes that we're seeking in the comp plan before it's passed. This is just a snapshot. To read the full statement, look at that tinyurl.com/CP Housing Justice. But essentially we are very concerned about preserving public housing, housing the unhoused, expanding rental subsidies, promoting community-led equitable development, and expanding rent control as key aspects of making sure that the city has the affordable housing that we all know we need. If you haven't signed, if you represent an organization, or if you're an ANC or an elected representative of an organization like a civic association, we would love to have you sign on to this statement. You can do that at the tiny URL at the bottom, /housing justice sign on. And this is a snapshot of the groups who've signed on so far. Those highlighted in, are the ones that have signed on since our last coalition meeting. And so we want to thank everybody for their support, and we will be calling on you in these last few weeks and these last few weeks as we expect to really be raising awareness. And before I go to our first speaker, I just want to remind those, especially who were not at our last couple meetings, that we've looked at this in depth over 4 years, and we really feel strongly that the comprehensive plan as proposed is a racist plan, because it will continue the harm that has been done over the last 20 years to Black residents and communities. It will not result in measurable improvements in the lives of Black residents and communities. And so, the fact that the comp plan does nothing to really stop the displacement of Black residents, that it doesn't improve the economic conditions, it does not improve or address the levels of housing that is affordable to majority of the city's Black families, and that it promotes changes in the future land use map that would actually eliminate public input, which somebody just put in the chat is not true, but I just wanna, I'll get into that right now, actually. So the future land use map is one of the maps that's part of the comprehensive plan. It is not itself the zoning map. However, because, as I mentioned earlier, the zoning has to follow the comp plan, once you change the map use, you then set the stage for changing the zoning. And changing the zoning is a rulemaking. It is not a contested case where you have the same level of notice and the same level of community engagement as you would if you were having a planned unit development hearing. So our concern is that by changing the future land use map throughout the city, especially in areas where the changes were not approved already through a community planning process, then you are undermining the ability of the residents to make sure that they win a strong community benefit agreement. And just briefly on that, is Pastor Monica Raines on the call right now? Let's see.
Hey, Parisa, yes, I'm here.
Okay, Pastor Raines, I wanna go ahead and give you an opportunity to speak briefly on this issue of changing the future land use map. Would you mind introducing yourself and sharing your perspective on that?
Hello, everyone. My name is Monica Rains. I'm the pastor at Christ United Methodist Church. Thank you so much for inviting us here to the meeting, and thank you to Parisa. It was really alarming to us and the leadership team at Christ Church to find out that the land use of our land had been proposed to be changed. And so we are a church. We are a church that has no plan for development. We know that many churches in this area have gone to a development model where they have like apartments and they have a church. We don't desire to do that. We right now are feeding our community. I'm not there because I'm here. We right now are feeding our community through our 5,000 food ministry and our mutual aid partnership. And we believe some of what I wrote in the letter was essentially when Parisa connected me to Andrew Trueblood, who is one of the leaders in, and Parisa, forgive me, I forget what office he leads. I don't have it in front of me, but he's one of the leaders, maybe in the comprehensive plan or maybe he's a city planner. And he told us that, you know, changing the land use of our congregation will not change anything, but that's not true. We already know developers have come and offered to develop our land. I've been given tickets to sit in the box on the wharf and all these things because people are desiring to take our land. Our land is worth, you know, probably a couple million dollars. The United Methodist Church bought it in the 60s. We own it outright. It is our land. And they desire to develop. We know, we think that in a couple of years, Christ Church will be the oldest building sitting on 4th and I, Christ Church and Amadon Bowen Elementary School. We will be the oldest buildings on this plan. We know they're building next to us, they're building in front of us, they're building behind us. The library was recently completed behind us. And so we believe that this land use change is a violation of our moral rights, even though the government has the right to change it without our permission, which is something that Mr. Andrew, I think Trueblood, wanted to make clear in the email he sent to Parisa and I, that they do not have to talk to us to be able to change the land use of our church, but it is wrong because we own the space. The Methodist Church owns the space. And so it is wrong because we know they desire to develop. We know they desire for, you know, they want city blocks to look the same. And if they're all going to be brand new buildings, they're going to want Christ Church to be a brand new building. And we have no plans of developing. I told Parisa and everybody else, I'm a young pastor. I'm going to be here for a long time. We have no plans of developing now, in the future, or later on. And so we are very offended that our land is slated to be changed as if they desire to put a building here, and we have no desire to change our land use. We believe that it is an infringement on our moral rights, and it is very similar to what happened in Southwest DC in the 40s and 50s, the African-American population that lived there, that they were essentially moved out of their land. Now, we own our land, and what everyone is saying is, oh, well, if you own your land, then they can't move you. They can't move us. But developers are going to start calling. They're going to start showing up. Once this is changed, I guarantee you the church phone during the day where we're supposed to be doing vital ministry, we're going to be fighting off developers who are desiring to develop our land. And so we believe it is an infringement on our moral rights. And we believe that we need to be consulted. No one was consulted in 2015. I was not the pastor then, but I've talked to the trustees and the leadership team. No one from our church was consulted when they started making plans for the land that our church sits on. And so that's pretty much the gist of it.
Thank you so much, Pastor Rains. We appreciate you being here to share that. And, you know, as Pastor Rains said, they're already getting harassed to develop their land in this area. And you see, I put up the map here where it says Christ United. That's Pastor Rains' church. Westminster is another church that is pursuing development and has requested, you know, a land use change. But as Pastor Rains stated, Christ United has not requested this, and much less requested. They actually weren't even informed or notified. The change in the future land use map was put in by Office of Planning. Any of the ones that start with 99 evidently are ones that Office of Planning itself recommends. But I did show briefly, and I'll go back to it quickly, that this is, you know, this is the Berry Farm community. And you see here in the area that has the black line around it, a section of the Berry Farm community that the Office of Planning is also seeking to change the future land use map. And this is the Cromell School in Ivy City and the two parcels adjacent to it. Again, the Office of Planning approved, on this case, it was applied for by Holland and Knight on behalf of developers, but it has not been part of a community planning process. And it does, again, it puts a lot of pressure on development in this area without a plan that could further circumvent the ability of the community to make sure that they get strong community benefits. So I wanna thank you again, Pastor Rains. And I'm gonna turn it over to Chris Williams, who is also active in the Southwest area that Pastor Rains was speaking of. And Chris is going to share a little bit of history as well as some of the current planned unit developments that are being proposed and how little affordability they really offer. Chris, I've made you co-host, so you should be able to share your screen.
Okay, thank you so much, Parissa, and thank you, Pastor Monica. What the Christ United Methodist Church is doing in the Southwest neighborhood is just so amazing and such an asset to the community. So thank you. I would like to share, as has been mentioned, the role of urban renewal and what that means for us now. This is not a history lesson. This is to show you all how urban renewal is very much connected to the issues of today. So you'll see that. I'll also talk about other areas of the city, but I really hope to tell a story so that you're not just seeing kind of facts and graphs, but really understand a picture. So many of you are probably familiar with urban renewal or Negro removal, where in Southwest, 560 acres of land were cleared of all buildings, many historic buildings, by the way. And it had the effect of displacing 23,000 residents in a predominantly African-American community. It was also a large white ethnic community. There was a lot large Jewish population, for example. And it represents one of the most tragic and racist forms of community development. Of course, many cities around the United States, both large and small, experience this form of urban renewal. Like many cities, there was an effort to put a highway through minority communities. It happened all across the United States, and Southwest was no exception. And so you see the map here, 395, 695, how it intersected what was otherwise going to Independence, a community, a historic community. So the Southwest Urban Renewal Plan that was put into place in the 1950s did not expire until 1998. That's important to know. Moreover, what that plan called for was for everything north of 395 to be office buildings. But again, because it expired in 1998, it thus opened up new avenues for residential development. And that's exactly what we saw. And so why all of this connects to urban renewal is because in the 1950s, we displaced tens of thousands of Black people and Jewish people to say, oh, we need office buildings. We need LaFont Plaza. And now we're saying, oh, you know what? We're probably better off having residential areas. But as I will show you, what we're building in terms of residential areas is not fair housing. And on the whole, it is not accommodating where Black people are economically. And so you're having development all in this red area that was before for office space. So the very first residential building to go up since urban renewal was 1331 Maryland Avenue. So this was land, to sort of contextualize this, this now sits on land that was formerly owned by the Redevelopment Land Agency associated with urban renewal. So it was public land. And that particular development delivered 373 units. DMPED's website indicates that there's no affordable units associated with this development. And let's take a look. If you wanted to rent a one bedroom at 1331 Maryland, be prepared to shell out upwards of $4,000. This is where we are. $4,000 for a one bedroom that, by the way, is now available. But there are other developments north of 395. There's 555 East Street, which is a public project. And we're told that 31% of the units are affordable at 50 to 60% AMI. But even so, that is really still higher than the median Black household income. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. Black income, to help you understand where we are in terms of income inequality, racial inequality, is that one third of neighborhoods in Washington, D.C. saw a decline in the median Black household income between 2010 and 2019. A third of D.C. neighborhoods. That's really just unremarkable that could occur. Or remarkable that could occur. During that period from 2010 to 2019, the median household income by neighborhood for Blacks only increased by $7,000 in a 10-year period, roughly. Meanwhile, you had the white median household income increased by $32,000. This is where we are. And so when it comes to housing, it's important to be very clear about what we mean when we're talking about affordability. For whom? At what AMI? So let's talk about another building. This one has not yet been built. That's also north of 395. It's called the Cotton Annex Building. You may have heard of it recently. It was a government building that was sold during the Trump administration, a federal government building. And they are proposing 8% of units to be affordable between 50 to 80% AMI, which is really well beyond the, at 80%, you're well beyond where the median Black household income is. And I'll show you those numbers in just a moment. So 8%. The Douglas development is directed by a man who was recently pardoned by former President Trump from charges stemming from, quote, from his efforts to influence a DC official for lucrative government leases. So this development, Cotton Annex, is a Douglas development. I want to also connect the dots for you between urban renewal and what's going on now in another way. I just went to Douglas Development's website today, took a screenshot of what they said were their leadership team. That's on the right. And I also happen to have a picture, a photo op from urban renewal with President Eisenhower in the 1950s. And you tell me what has changed. I dare say nothing. This is also taken from the Douglas Development website. It has properties, dozens of properties that this development company has constructed. So as you can see, they have a wide reach and high impact throughout the DMV. So I want to talk about a development in Ivy City that they are leading. This is a PUD, a planned unit development. They're saying they want to deliver 859 residential units, and that 80% of those residential units will be affordable. This is what they are selling to the public. But let's unpack what they mean by affordable. The majority of what they mean by affordable is 80% AMI. So 75% of affordable units are at 80% AMI. So let's see what those numbers are. So this is the table that's published on the DC website. And here is 80% median family income. For one person, $70,000. If you have two people in your household, it's $80,000. So I happen to have, on account of my position at the University of Maryland, access to a lot of data. So I ran the numbers and I looked at every neighborhood. We had 147 neighborhoods or census tracts. And I said, well, what is the Black median household income in each of those tracts? And so those are the little dots that you see there on the left. And then I did something simple. I said, well, sort by smallest to largest, and how many of those neighborhoods have a Black median household income less than $70,000? And remind you, $70,000 is the threshold of 80% MFI for one person in your household. 75% of neighborhoods have Black median household income less than $70,000. If we look at $80,000, it's 78%. But this only tells you at the neighborhood level. What I'm about to show you, I hope, drives the message home. So then I said, well, what's the distribution of Black people in these various census tracts? So I mentioned the household, the neighborhood, 78% of the neighborhoods have less than $70,000 as the Black median income. Well, how many Black people live in those neighborhoods? The vast majority of Black residents. In fact, 264,000. In other words, when we're talking about planned unit developments like Ivy City, when we're talking about what they're doing in Southwest, not to mention other places, and they're saying, oh, we'll give you affordability at 60% AMI, 80% AMI, 80%, by the way, Randall School, if you've heard that in Southwest, that's also how we're getting, quote, affordable. The Black wealth is just not there to afford these units. It's just not there. And so if you see the households that are the number of people in neighborhoods with more than 70,000, it pales in comparison. It's 56,000. So the takeaway message, to reiterate what Parissa has already said, the takeaway message is that the comp plan is racist. Planning in DC is racist because it doesn't account for what's happening in Black families' lives and the money that's coming in, and how they can or cannot afford these new units, and mostly they can't afford them, okay? So thank you very much. I'm very proud to be a steering committee member of the DC Grassroots Planning Coalition. I'm also editor-in-chief of Southwest Voice, and I also have a position at the University of Maryland. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Chris, really appreciate that. And, you know, again, we will share slides. We will also share the video of this meeting. These are topics that we get into every month. So feel free to join us and let us know topics that you want to delve deeper into. Right now, we're going to invite a couple of Ward 7 residents to share their concerns about the proposed streetcar extension into Ward 7 and how it would impact them. I believe David Belt, are you on the line? If so, please unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great.
Are you going to be
serious trouble?
Oh, okay. Are you going to be joining video or not?
Let's see. Am I going to be on video?
Yes. Just so I know, I'm going to also invite Edith Hancock to unmute.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I can see myself on there.
Okay. That's okay. So what I'm going to do is, David, I'm going to go ahead and pull up the slides that you sent me.
Okay, hold on.
Edith, are you there as well? You want to unmute as well?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, wonderful. So David prepared a few slides to go through. Why don't we start with that, and then Edith would love for you to chime in as well. And again, this is not a topic we'll be able to do full justice to, but we want to touch on it because it has been a hot topic and it's something that we can come back to with more depth. David, are you ready for me to start sharing your slides?
Yes. You can hear me okay?
Yeah, go ahead and start your presentation.
Okay. Good afternoon, all. I would like to point out only a few of the many reasons that are very concerning to the residents of this beautiful residential neighborhood along Benning Road. We will look at why DDOT is so adamant about emphasizing that no eminent domain will be necessary and everything will be done with DDOT's right of way. This being purposely deceitful to the community and will result in the displacement of homeowners and the decimation of property values. Let me give a little history about this portion of right-of-way that DDOT is speaking of. Beginning with the Lafont Plan and continuing to today, Washington, D.C. has a notable history of using public space to define the city and give character and grace to neighborhoods. From inspirational views of the Capitol along leafy avenues to neighborhood networks of small green spaces, parks, schoolyards, and recreation centers to commercial boulevards with sidewalk cafes and street festivals. These defining characteristics of our public space are not the result of happenstance. Rather, it is the result of thoughtful planning, regulation, and longstanding traditions of enhancing the public right-of-way. Washington, D.C. has a long history of using public space to define its image. Beginning with the Lafont Plan, the images were characterized by wide streets with long views towards prominent buildings or open spaces. In 1870, Congress passed the Parking Act and designated part of the right-of-way immediately next to private property as park area to be maintained by the adjacent property owner. A second law dealing with public parking was passed in 1872. It required property owners to maintain the public parking directly abutting their property while giving the property owner the exclusive right to enter that public space. This area was to be landscaped and is still referred to as parking. What's not often realized is that this setback is caused by the legal width of the streets, the right of way, being considerably greater than the actual physical width of the street plus sidewalk. When this city was first laid out, the plans called for very wide streets, but the city didn't build the streets to the full legal width, leaving unused right-of-way alongside these streets. The district retains legal title to the space, but puts it under the immediate care and keeping of the owners or occupants of the premises abutting on the public parking. This unused district space is called a parking because it's supposed to be maintained in the manner of parkland, not because anybody can park cars on it. Today, wide streets with long vistas are still a defining characteristic of the residential and commercial neighborhoods in the district and differentiate the city from surrounding jurisdictions. This image is the result of policies and regulations that few people are aware of, but that many people benefit from. The impact they have on enhancing the transportation network and defining the image of the district is largely unappreciated. The way public space is used and designed impacts residents, workers, and visitors. Consistent application and enforcement of public space policies and regulations give our city a distinct character defined by open spaces and results in a greener and more walkable city. Slide two, please. Now to the streetcar. There's a reason Metro does not run its 60-foot long accordion buses through this section of Benning Road, and it's not to make room for a 66-foot long streetcar. This residential section of Benning Road has a beautiful street vista, as well as being adjacent to the Fort Mahan National Park and rivals any other in our city. Slide three, please. Now, in order to fit the streetcar down this residential section of Benning Road, DDOT proposes to widen the street anywhere from 6 to 20 feet to accommodate wider lanes and in places a 12-foot median for passengers. Guess where that right of way will come from? Slide four, please. These photos were taken of the ribbons placed by DDOT on the fences of property owners, including Stewart's Funeral Home, with ROW written on them, meaning right of way. Yeah, right there where you're pointing, the little orange ribbon there, and the other side of the yard is on the other, that's the other side of the yard. DDOT is proposing that they can take this portion of property for the streetcar without consent or compensation to the owners. Slide five. This is an aerial where you can see the front yard, which is, see the highlighted lot? The front yard just before that, just ahead of that, the highlight right there. They can take all that, that entire front yard that's been manicured, well kept. So slide six will give you an idea of the map. Everything beyond the property line, DDOT is calling fair game. That's the lines closest to the street, those lines right there on both sides. DDOT is calling fair game. This destroys everything this city pretends to promote as far as livable, green, walkable communities, and is an unconscionable breach of the trust between the city and its property owners. This should be concerning to every property owner in the city if this dangerous precedent is set. Slide seven, please. Now, with respect to time constraints, I'll just mention a few other concerns not truthfully addressed by either DDOT or the project manager. Benning Road is a designated evacuation route. That's what the DC flag emblem means on the street sign. Number two, it was verified that no eminent domain would be used. However, DDOT is using the public parking area that is unknown to most as a technicality to unjustly seize this portion of property. Three, the fact that the mature tree canopy along the neighborhood would be removed. This is big since it takes 20 to 30 years for these trees to mature, where they are invaluable in improving the air quality, deadening the noise and vibration from traffic, absorbing stormwater runoff, and energy conservation for the homeowners along Benning Road, not to mention the beauty that they impart on the streetscape. Also, the issues of the streetcar's protocol when approaching stopped emergency vehicles. This is as per FEMS. is to stop until the emergency vehicle has cleared. This is a huge problem when running down a street with only two lanes each way in an already increasingly congested thoroughfare. Last, there is the issue of large delivery trucks, buses, construction trucks, as well as just heavy traffic, now traveling within 15 feet of some residents' front doors, as they will likely be traveling in the curb lane. DDOT has given no logical reason as to why it is so insistent to bring an unwanted, unreasonable, expensive streetcar project that will not serve this community, nor will it bring any return on investment to the city. The only obvious motivation behind this particular portion of this project would be to encourage displacement and decimate an established low to middle class African-American community in the name of greed and gentrification. The objective is forced displacement with the intention of upzoning to create a mixed commercial corridor. Thank you. I'll leave room for any questions or anything that you might want to add.
Thank you, David. First, let's go to Edith, and then we can take a couple minutes for questions. Edith, please go ahead and introduce yourself and share your thoughts on this.
Yeah, hi. I'm Edith Hancock. I'm a resident of native of Ward 7. And just to give some other points that David gave an excellent presentation. I just wanted to chime in that I've listened to all the arguments that the supporters of the streetcar have given. I just wanted to be clear that there's a small subset of Ward 7 residents that support this, but they don't speak for the whole. The majority of Ward 7 residents aren't even aware of what is being proposed. And also too, they're trying to use this as a tool for development. They're trying to say that the streetcar will promote infrastructure upgrades and boost development. They're trying to draw a parallel between what had happened on 8th Street to what could happen on Bedding Road. Okay, again, I wanna reiterate that as those who are on the call understand, development does not happen in 1 or 2 year cycles. There are planned out at least 20 years prior to. So the development was already in the works when the streetcar was being proposed to DC. Also too, and I have said this to Parisa, we have to understand where the funding came from when the streetcar was rolled out on 8th Street in circa 2010. I was in talks to the former chair of the ANC 7D Transportation Committee. And he reminded me that the original plan had started with Mayor Williams to do a light rail that would connect from Bowling Air Force Base running through Ward 8 to dead stop at Minnesota Avenue. It was going to run next to the existing train tracks, not interfering in residential neighborhoods. The way that we have the streetcar now, and if memory serves me right, and unfortunately I don't have the data to support it right now for this meeting, was that it was the streetcar is envisioned for 8th Street was done as a quote tourist attraction, not as mass transit. It was not designed to, because development was already underway, investment was already underway when the streetcar was done, was introduced. And it has been a pariah because it is it has not realized any profit. So the question, it begs the question, why are we doing a streetcar that only goes four blocks? What is the benefit? And if those who don't know the community, we already have 4 subway stops that touch our community. So if having 4 subway stops is not boosted development, then what is the holdup? The other function of it as well is that we're being basically extorted in our community. We're being told in order for us to get a new bridge and to get the racial inequities of our transportation of ingress and egress remedied, we and to connect us 295, connecting communities to the rest of the city, we have to have the streetcar, which is a backdoor way of extorting us, strong arming us. And I think that came from our council member. The funding had already been allocated through the American Reinvestment Act for, excuse me, infrastructure enhancements. Again, I have no data to back me up, but I am doing research on that. It looks like the money was allocated to funding the streetcar, because again, going on Justin Leaney's research, 50% of the funding for the streetcar came from grant money from the Federal Department of Transportation. So it begs you start putting 2 and 2 together. The money should have been allocated to a new Benning Road Bridge, and to remedy the traffic mess under the bridge with 295. So I just wanted to point out some of the disparities and some of the arguments, but the biggest thing is that this is not alignment. This is not in an alignment with the Biden administration as far as climate change. You're wanting to level mature trees, the tree canopy. As David said, it takes 30 to 40 years to get this type of carbon neutralizing agriculture within a community. And I don't know if anyone has experienced U Street in the summer, but you're already going to create a heat island. Again, we have been advocating for the circulator, and all of the arguments about the streetcar being energy efficient, et cetera, go out the window, because there are now companies producing electric vehicles from mass transit buses to even trash trucks are being produced that are electric. So there's not a salient reason as to why we are needing this. There's no argument that has been given that make any sense. Again, it's not a tool for development. What if you want, there are a lot of other things that the district can do for direct investment to spur business investment, okay? And I also wanna just to backdoor a little bit to the prior, and I'm not gonna hold you too much longer, but just to piggyback on what the prior gentleman gave as far as the comprehensive plan, I would beg to differ one thing, okay? No one's really understood the money flows within the Black community, okay? Especially in the Black community in DC. First of all, there's been a concerted effort to drive down the AMI in our community because it's concentrated poverty. But what is not taken into account are the multiple generations living in these communities, and also the amount of disposable income that is in our community, okay? And the fact that we have seniors that are on pensions that are, and we have homes that are paid for. So there are a lot of different ways to look at economics other than the flat numbers, because there's a lot of wealth in our community that's not being targeted. And I'm gonna end it there, because I just wanted to get that point in, because those, you can't just look at our community from one lens. There's a lot of wealth, there's a lot of disposable income, and this streetcar is also, last point, blocking our the evacuation route as well. So again,
thank you so much, Ms. Hancock and Mr. Belt. And if there are questions, we're going to have to hold them until after the chairman comes and joins us. So if you could put your questions in the chat, and Ms. Hancock and Mr. Belt, if you could stay on the line, I want to make sure we get an opportunity to direct some of those questions. And as I said, you know, this is a full conversation that we just wanted to highlight a snapshot of it. We're happy to create more space at a future meeting, but both of you raised so many issues that go back to the failure of the city to do adequate planning. And obviously that's a focus of our coalition and something outside of the comp plan we'll continue to work on. The chairman is expected to join us in about 5 minutes. I did want to invite Sheldon Rep from the Committee of 100 to give us a few minutes on this new program that the city's been touting as their cure for affordable housing, the Inclusionary Zoning Plus. Shelley, are you with us?
Yes, I'm on. Can you hear me?
You can. Okay, I'm going to spotlight you. And yeah, please, if we could try for about 5 minutes and we'll continue as needed after the chairman's speech. Go ahead.
Okay, I will. Thank you for this opportunity to speak on behalf of the Committee of 100. Inclusionary Zoning Plus was approved by the DC Zoning Commission on March 11th. The concept was originally proposed by the Office of Planning to increase the amount of affordable housing produced through MAP amendments. In other words, it only applies through upzoning. The policy goal is to capture some of the increased density resulting from upzoning for affordable housing. However, I think we've run through, the Committee of 100 has run through an analysis here, and we think the result will be minimal at best, and it may in fact provide less affordable housing than is the case under regular IZ, which is in effect today. Regular IZ has produced in the last 10 years just 1,200 affordable units, just a drop in the bucket compared to the need for affordable housing. And just mention that there are over 8,000 households that are registered for an affordable unit under the IZ program. The concern with the Office of Planning's proposal that was approved is expressed by Committee of 100 is that the related affordable housing benefits will at best be minimal and could result in displacement of the very families IZ is intended to help. In fact, in some instances, fewer affordable units may be produced under IZ Plus than would be generated under regular IZ. Overall, the program, overall, the proposal benefits developers and investors without making much of a dent in the city's affordable housing need, especially at the lowest income levels. The record of IZ Plus's evolution since it was originally introduced reveals the Office of Planning's willingness to bend over backwards to adopt the positions of the District of Columbia Building Industry Association, DCBIA. As an example, on December 28th, 2020, the final day for the public comment on the original notice of proposed rulemaking, DCBIA submitted a comment requesting that the IZ Plus requirement be revised so that the affordable housing requirement is calibrated to the density that is utilized as a result of the MAP amendment. On January 21st, 2021, the Office of Planning revised its IZ proposal, discarding the original measure it had advertised to the public and substituting almost verbatim DCBIA's formula. We also note that the the bonus density arm of the inclusionary zoning formula is missing from IZ Plus. This is an alternative requirement for IZ based on the bonus density provided for calculating the IZ requirement. If under the alternative arm, it results in a higher affordable housing requirement. We, the Committee of 100, did run an example to show what this the IZ Plus would produce. We used the Mazza Gallery as an example, currently zoned as MU7, and we ran numbers to see what would happen if the lot was upzoned to be MU10. While there's a lot of it's a detailed computation, I won't go through right now. But the bottom line is that that under IZ Plus, and given this hypothetical example, the developer would be granted additional density of 200,000 square feet, and the IZ set aside requirement under IZ Plus would increase only 1,660 feet over what would be required under regular IZ. And as a matter of fact, if the developer took advantage of a 20% reduction in the set aside in cases where there's more multifamily on multi-bedroom apartments, that the reduction would be an actual reduction of 5,330 square feet. Bottom line, there is reason to believe that the proposal in practice will provide cover for developers requesting map amendments to upzone their property without resulting in significant amounts of affordable housing. So that's in a nutshell, that's the summary.
Thank you so much, Shelley. We really appreciate that. And for all of us, I think we need to go over that again at some point and look at those numbers. But I wanted to go ahead and at least, you know, raise it and give you a chance to speak to it briefly to whet everybody's appetite to learn more, because this is the big thing that the mayor's office and the Office of Planning have been touting as their big program now to address affordability. So again, not only does it still not, inclusionary zoning has never and still does not address lowest income housing, it doesn't touch 30% of the area median income at all, but the calculations being done are showing that in some cases it may actually reduce the amount of affordable housing that it will benefit developers who are seeking greater density. And even just your statement about the proposal being changed, you know, to really reflect what the DC Building Industry Association was promoting should give us pause. So these are just examples of how we need to dig deeper when we hear about, you know, something from the mayor's office that is supposedly gonna address our affordability issues. If you have questions, please put them in the chat and we will reserve some time at the end of the meeting to go through those. Has the chairman joined us yet? If not, we will. Okay, I haven't heard him. So what I'm gonna do is ask for either William Jordan or Nick Deladon to share with us which one of you is prepared to.
I'm ready to go.
Ready to go. Okay, wonderful. Go ahead, William. William is part of our steering committee. He's going to share with us an update about the Council Office on Racial Equity's upcoming racial equity impact assessment.
Good afternoon. My name is William Jordan. I live in Ward 1 in the Columbia Heights neighborhood, and I'm going to touch on the new racial equity efforts in Washington, D.C. Before I touch that, living in Columbia Heights, we've already experienced all the candy that the Office of Planning is selling, and we know it was a con. Columbia Heights, when I moved here in the early 1990s, our population was 70% Black, and I'm sure that when the census numbers come out in September, it will be between 15 and 20% Black. Most of the development has been subsidized either directly by government finance as well as government land. So the issue is not that so much that developers come in with private money and it's doing all this development. The issue is we are subsidizing our own displacement, particularly for Black residents, and not reaping the promised benefit. And I think this is why we want to look at the Council's Office on Racial Equity. So Kenyon McDuffie, Councilmember Kenyon McDuffie, a couple years ago, along with the support of other residents, came up with the a Racial Equity Act for the District of Columbia as a new law. That law was introduced 2 years ago, and it really took 2 years before the law actually became law. And the law speaks to the executive side, primarily what the mayor's agencies and what the mayor does. The council, as part of the racial equity, created its own office, and that is the Council Office for Racial Equity Core. And they actually named it after the core we know from the civil rights era. And it was done actually on MLK's birthday this past year is when they kicked it off. So the job of CORE now, like the CFO does, is to analyze bills and laws that the council proposes or that the mayor proposes to determine their impact on racial equity. And so this seems to be a good thing because finally we're going to have a way to look at how Black residents in particular, but other residents overall, are being impacted by these new laws, new investments, and all the things that come through the district government. So the racial, the Office of Racial Equity Core does what they call a racial impact assessment. So any bill that goes through the council is supposed to get this analysis. And the analysis is going to look at the bill, look at the data, look at the impact, and make a determination on that bill. And the result will be either site, this bill will advance racial equity in the District of Columbia, or they will stamp the bill. This bill has the potential to exacerbate racial inequity in the District of Columbia. So that's the job of this office for every bill coming forward. The first bill that this will be applied to, or major bill it will be applied to, will be the city's comprehensive plan that was introduced, that basically has OPs, the Office of Planning's amendments to the comp plan, and pretty much what we've been talking about over the last couple of years, and determine if the comp plan will advance racial equity, or it will determine whether it has the potential to exacerbate racial inequity in the district. And I think our group and my experiences in Columbia Heights and those we're talking about today, we're pretty confident that the plan is going to be potential exacerbate racial inequities in the District of Columbia. And so that's what the whole purpose of the bill. The Racial Equity Office is headed by Mr. McClure. And we're looking forward to that analysis. It's my understanding that prior to the council marking up the comp plan, that bill will come out, or really the assessment will come out at least a day or two before, hopefully a week or two before, to give us an opportunity to review that analysis. Couple things I wanted to throw in, and it kind of relates to the presentations before. I mean, one thing to know about Columbia Heights is that when they did urban renewal in Southwest, many of those residents ended up in Columbia Heights in the 60s and are part of our community today. So while some people were displaced outside of the city, many people were moved to the 14th Street corridor because at that time it was affordable. So a couple of things we want to do too is look at when evaluating what is racial equity. How do you determine whether something is furthering in advancing racial equity or something is exacerbating the inequities. So a couple of things we can look at is the median Black household income. So if it furthers it, we would expect income to rise as a result of the bill or the comp plan. The other thing is wealth. We know that Black wealth is white wealth is 81 times Black wealth minimally, right, in this city. And the average Black income is around 41,000 and average white income is about 120,000 per year. So the racial inequity gaps are very strong. So how do you close those gaps or at least advance racial equity? Again, you would have to see income increase for Black residents. And that means you would have to see employment situation increase, the wages people make increase, the job opportunities increase, and that the and then the other aspect to this is housing. So if the housing is affordable, what affordable housing really means is that it frees up other income, disposable income, to take advantage of other aspects of life. It really does nobody any good to pay a little bit of rent, but even after their affordable rent, there's no money to do anything with except barely pay for food. So people's income must rise along with having affordable housing in order to achieve racial equity. The other aspect is home ownership, and this is probably where the rubber meets the road. The city's policies, even for housing, even for affordable housing, concentrates on rental housing, whether it's market rate or affordable. However, if you want to advance racial equity, a percentage of that has to be home ownership, right? And a percentage of that has to be family size home ownership in order to provide that foundation. And if you look at the type of developments that the city, not only are happening in the city, but more so that the city is subsidizing, there's almost no home ownership opportunities. And almost all of the units are smaller than what would be required for families. So I will say that, and then also end with the mayor's side of this bill is also coming forward. So the mayor has to build an infrastructure for evaluating racial equity in her government, and she has not started that at all. And so while the council has a method to look at bills, the mayor has no infrastructure in place that we know of to do that. So the mayor's policy and what the Office of Planning does and DDOT and you name it, does not take into account racial equity. In fact, I looked at the Office of Planning's oversight report and looked for the word racial equity, and they didn't even mention it for their performance in 2020, when 2020 was the year of racial equity in this whole nation. So in our nation, with COVID-19, with Floyd's death and the protests and everything going on, OP in all 2020 had no mention of racial equity. So that will tell you where we are and what we have to battle in there.
Thank you so much, William. I appreciate that. And again, if folks have questions for William, we'll please put them in the chat and we will try to get to them after. We are now joined by the Council Chairman Phil Mendelson. We want to thank you, Chairman, for joining us today, and invite you to give an opening. I don't know, any kind of statement that you want to make, and we would certainly appreciate an update on timing and process for the comprehensive plan. And then we have a few questions we sent you ahead of time. We'll go through and then open it up for questions from the audience, if that's okay. Thank you again for being here.
Yes, that is okay. And if you sent the questions, I'm not sure I saw them, but that's okay. I think the questions are the more valuable part of this. I try to make myself available whenever you invite me. And I hope that there hasn't been an occasion I've said no. I think it's important to be accessible. The Committee of the Whole, to my surprise, had another hearing on the comprehensive plan this past week. It actually was a performance oversight hearing on the Office of Planning, but somehow there were something like 40 witnesses who testified about the comprehensive plan. I actually, some of you will know this because you were there, asked Cheryl Court if she could speak to some of the objections that had been raised. And her comment was that she had not known that this had been a hearing on the comprehensive plan, or she would have tried to make sure there were a lot of people attending with her point of view. Doesn't matter, because the hearings are fair game for discussion of important issues like the plan. I have promised all along that I would do my best to get the comprehensive plan out before the budget comes to the council. And that's still my commitment. I have to say that the work has taken longer and been more difficult than I had thought. And the fact that the budget has been delayed by 3 weeks gives me a little bit of wiggle room, but we are working hard to try to get the document done. I've not committed to how quickly I will release the document, but I will not release it the day before the council vote. So there'll be at least a few days for the public to be able to look at the plan. I want to note that we vote twice on bills. So there will be, I will release the draft of what I circulate. There might be some revisions to that that will then be circulated the day before the markup, and then there'll be a vote 2 weeks after, the final vote 2 weeks after that. If there's enough controversy, I could delay the second reading. Not that I'm inviting that, but I recognize it's important that folks have an opportunity to look at the document. And to that end, I have complained, and this is really not your business, but I've complained that the Office of Planning really would have done us all a favor if it had come up with a shorter document rather than a longer document. And many of the changes that they've made, I view as unnecessary. They're not of concern to anybody. So we have a 1500 page document before us. I wanna emphasize that what we have is a plan. It's the comprehensive plan is a plan. And the only part of it that is truly binding on the government is any aspects of the plan that implicate zoning. Because as you know, the home rule acts says zoning shall not be inconsistent with the comprehensive plan. So there's a lot of very nice language in it about, or there will be a lot of very nice language in it about education, about human service programs, but none of that is binding on the government. The zoning aspects are. So we're working on this. And I think with that, I'll open it up to questions.
Okay, and just to clarify a couple quick things before, and I want to invite everybody to put their questions in the chat. We were testifying about the performance of the Office of Planning, that is the lead agency on the comp plan. And we weren't really speaking, I think, to a lot of the specific details of the plan itself, but the process that the Office of Planning really had not followed as outlined in the statute. So just to from our perspective, we were speaking directly to the performance of the Office of Planning. Can you share what types of changes you're most focused on? You've said that, it's the parts that relate to zoning and it are the only binding parts, but in the past you've kind of given, housing, land use, historic preservation, these are some of your focus chapters. Can you give us any more detail about the types of changes that you're really looking at for your draft?
Well, we are, let me see, the Office of Planning submitted this proposal in April last year. And I only say that because where we are today in our thinking is a little different than where we were a year ago in our thinking, our being the city or the public's thinking. The Office of Planning tried to put more focus on housing and affordable housing. And we're looking at even more focus on housing and affordable housing. I'm not sure that the Office of Planning really was looking at racial equity issues. This did predate the murder of George Floyd and the heightened sensitivity that resulted. We are looking at that. The other plan-wide issue is that I'm speaking generally here, the Office of Planning, as you know, tried to make the plan more flexible. And I think they did that to protect the plan from the kind of challenges to planned unit developments that have taken place. But then that comes up against, conflicts, if you will, with, in my view, the important quality of a plan, which is that a plan should be a guide. If it's too general, it's not much of a guide. Or maybe I could put that different. Is this to be a general guide or a more specific guide? And I've indicated that I don't think it's in the best interest of the public or a very good plan if it's too general. So we're looking at some of the language that the Office of Planning proposed to changing shall protect, to they proposed changing that to should protect. We're looking at those language changes. We are spending some time, unfortunately, I say that with a little bit of sarcasm, on some of the elements that don't directly implicate zoning. Because if we are going to adopt policies, even if they aren't binding, we still want them to be right. So we are looking at, for instance, housing could or the housing element could have some effect on the zoning, but to a large extent it won't, but we're spending some time with the housing element, for example.
Can you share, have you been in communication with the Council Office on Racial Equity, and have they shared any concerns with you already that you may incorporate into your draft?
We have had conversations with them because that's the way the process is supposed to work. Now, this may be the first bill that goes to the council that will have a racial equity assessment. The way the process is supposed to work, and so what we are doing is we've informed the racial equity office, the CORE, Council Office on Racial Equity, we've informed CORE that we're moving forward with the bill. That's what every committee is supposed to do. They're supposed to do that at least 10 days in advance, if I remember correctly. Well, we've done it already. And then CORE is supposed to work with the committee or vice versa to go through issues or questions or concerns. So that's been taking place. And there are, for example, places in the plan as the mayor proposed it where it was, the language is unaware of racial equity as an issue. So a lot of the conversation we're having is how to, where in the plan, where in the language there needs to be a acknowledgement of racial equity.
Okay, thank you for that. So we're gonna open it up to other questions. Paul has been monitoring the chat and he's gonna read out some questions. While we get him ready, Chairman, can you just speak to the future land use map and the generalized policy map? Will you release those when you release the rest of the draft for markup? And where are you on some of the proposals from the Office of Planning that don't have community support?
Well, on that last point, virtually everything in the plan has support from somebody other than just simply the executive. With regard to the map, I think that what we will be releasing is the text of the print. And we are not going to draw a new map. We're going to follow the process that's been done in the past, which is to explain where we are making changes to what the Office of Planning proposed and instructing the Office of Planning to come back with a revised map at some point after the plan is adopted. And that's the practice that we've followed and the council's followed in the past. So pick an area. So the Office of Planning, let's say, took 13th and Pennsylvania Avenue Northwest and they upflumbed it to high density residential. And we think it should be moderate density residential. We won't have a map. We're not gonna revise the map, but we will have text that will say the following changes to what the Office of Planning proposed, 13th and Pennsylvania Avenue is moderate density.
We have a few people who've requested to ask their questions out loud. I'm gonna go to some of the chat questions first and then try to, if we can keep it moving, then we'll have time for a couple people to ask audibly. Paul, are you ready?
I am ready, yes. So we have, I think you asked Caroline's question. So Edith Hancock asked Mr. Chairman if you could clarify the inputs into the comprehensive plan.
I don't understand the question.
I think she had she wanted to ask hers audibly. So we'll go ahead, Edith, go ahead and unmute and just try to keep it brief.
Yeah, I am. Okay, so I saw someone in the chat kind of touched on this. I had a conversation with former chair Sharice Muhammad of 7D. Does it make sense to go forward with this comprehensive plan in the light of COVID, the pandemic, right? Impacting density across the country. Everyone's rethinking density across the country in cities. Also, we're having the migration of people out of the city. We're losing population. And also with the impact of climate change. That's, in other words, the comprehensive plan as is written now or proposed now is looking at life as if this is 2013, not 2021. So there's been, to me, why aren't we rethinking and looking at it instead of having it's more of a developer-driven document and looking at the largest of the issues that we're looking at?
When you mention issues like climate change, the language that the Office of Planning submitted does try to account for that. And we've looked at that language with an eye toward where we think it could be strengthened. So climate change is already factored in. When you talk about 2013, if we don't do anything, then actually what we have for the next half a decade probably is a plan that was adopted in 2006, which was based on very different assumptions than what we have today. For instance, very little focus on housing, the need for housing, and no focus on racial equity as an issue. So if we don't move forward, we're stuck with that, which is will soon be 20 years old. You mentioned COVID. While COVID certainly has had a severe impact on us, I don't see, and I haven't seen persuasive testimony that COVID would substantially change the planning thinking, which is again, more housing and accounting for the population, which is considerably higher today than it was in 2006. I would add, even though you said the population is shrinking, the latest data I've seen is that the city is not shrinking. It may not be growing as fast, but I believe at Thursday's hearing or Wednesday's hearing, the Office of Planning testified that the population is still growing.
Thank you, Paul. Go ahead to the next one.
Okay, great. Meg McGuire wants to know, Mr. Chairman, what is your approach to the widespread FLUM amendments? Why would these amendments be adopted in the absence of a community-led smart area planning?
Well, some of the changes in the future land use map are supposed to be contingent on small area plans. And that's something that we're looking at. That was OP's proposal. And that's something we're looking at because while they said that was their intent, the language that they submitted doesn't hold them to that. But there are other changes in the map that aren't contingent on a small area plan. And I just have to say that we can't, it doesn't make sense that there would be no changes to the plan until there were small area plans. That would basically mean that the entire city has to have small area plans before there could be a plan. There are other changes to the land use map that I have to emphasize are maybe important to a ward council member. For instance, there was testimony at the hearing this past week about some upflumming that was objectionable. And I have to check where the ward member is in regard to that. And why? Because the fact is that if a ward member feels strongly about a change, then the council is likely to follow that ward member. And it doesn't do me any good to just either stick to what Office of Planning proposed or stick to what the community wants when the ward member is very, very oppositional. Now, there's some changes that a ward member doesn't care about. What am I trying to say here? If there is something that a change proposed that is important to you, you need to lobby and convince your ward member. That's just a fact, because there will be, chances are, if it's an issue the ward member feels strongly about, there will be seven members with that ward member. The other ward members, at a minimum, and as I recall, there are eight ward members, because they all are in this together. When I say in this together, ward members are all, they're all looking at this, and there's some changes that are important to them. So I know, for example, that there's a ward member who doesn't agree with the Office of Planning on some changes and is proposing different changes. And I'm actually negotiating with that ward member because I'm not sure I completely agree with what the ward member wants. But I have in the back of my mind that I have to be aware of how strongly the ward member feels, because the ward member, if they feel strongly, will come in with an amendment. And at a minimum, the other ward members are likely to follow them. So you need to look at the ward member.
Yeah, but Chairman, I just want to appeal to you that there's been no analysis about what the impact of these flum changes are. But there's a lot of differing opinions about how it forecloses communities' opportunity to negotiate through a PUD process and a community benefits agreement. And why would we be proposing flum changes, for instance, for land against the landowner's own knowledge in the case of Christ United? So I hear you, and we will do that. We will communicate with the ward council members, but you know, I hope that CORE raises this in their racial equity impact assessment. We don't have any analysis. What is the impact of this? Does it increase land speculation? Does it increase land values? Does it increase development pressure? Does it foreclose community opportunity to engage in a full process? So, you know, that's just our concern. Those questions really have not been adequately answered. Andrew Trueblood just says, oh, it doesn't change anything. That's his response. Well, if it doesn't change anything, then he wouldn't be so hell-bent on doing it. So clearly it changes something. It gives the developers a leg up in the development process.
Sure. Again, you know, in the end, this is about my being able to manage the bill through the council.
I understand, yeah.
There are changes that I don't particularly like, but I have to be mindful of whether a majority of the council would be supportive of that, of the change nevertheless, and where can I find a compromise?
Okay, we'll go to Chris Otten real quick, and then we're gonna go to your next question, Paul, from the chat.
Great. Chris, you can unmute. Yes, excuse me, hi. Good afternoon. Mr. Mendelson,
planning is not a popularity contest. And by the way, the ward level council members are just as influenced as OP is by developer money. And so whether you're for or against upzoning via upflumming, that's not the question here. The question here is planning getting done? Are we repairing the harms of the past and mitigating the harms of the future? And so when my council member, Brianne Nadeau, for the first time in the 4 years that this has been going on, releases upflumming up and down Adams Morgan's Columbia Road, down on U Street, on Florida Ave, hundreds of thousands of square feet, maybe, you know, of upflumming, upzoning, 2 weeks before you're going to do a markup on that. I have to wonder, is this planning or is this just developer wish list being implemented by the council? Now, we have raised, and Renee Bowser's done this clearly several times, there are laws around planning and in this city. We've raised DC Code 1-306.04D, DC Municipal Regulations 10A 2512.1 and 0.2, 2515.2 and 0.3, and the Language Access Act. By the way, nobody who does not speak English first was a participant in any of these discussions because none of these documents were translated ever by the Office of Planning. We want to put you on notice for the last time that these laws mean planning needs to be done with these proposed upflumming, AKA upzoning proposals. 200 million square feet, as Andrew Trueblood has admitted to me by email, not online on plandc.dc.gov. So for the last time, we're going to put you on notice. We have attorneys ready to take the city to court to embarrass you and this whole process for its failure to actually plan, because planning in this city is not a popularity contest. And you know what? 40,000 Black folks being displaced is a harm. Between 2000 and 2010, the census numbers are going to come out between 2010 and 2020. Why aren't we waiting until we see the reality of what this planning has done to our favorite friends and neighbors in the city over the last decade? I'll leave it at that.
Well, I'm not sure what to say. I'm reasonably confident that the census will show our population has grown considerably in the past decade and that our population is over 700,000. I'm reasonably confident of that. And the numbers I've seen from both the chief financial officer as well as from the Office of Planning, which is where our census demography office is that our population continues to grow even though substantially slower pace. But Chris, I wanna emphasize that if you think that the answer to getting the plan is to sue, I'm afraid you're gonna be misplaced. There've been decades of litigation over the comprehensive plan. I don't think you'll succeed. What I want to emphasize is that this is political. Now, you know, I'm meeting with you because I think that's important. And you can put political pressure on me, and that's fine. But you have to focus on the ward members. So if you're unhappy with what Councilmember Nadeau has proposed, there have to be folks in Ward 1 who make it clear that what she's proposing is unacceptable. Now, I've begun some conversations with her office. I'm not gonna go into the details there, but in the end, how far I can push back is really gonna depend upon how much pressure there is within the ward. If people are mostly quiet, or Chris, you're a minority in the ward, then what she proposes is likely to be approved by the council, except to the extent that I'm able to negotiate some changes. This.
Chris, real quick,
so what's being proposed is upflumming from moderate density, so we're talking four-story buildings, to medium density, which are nine-story buildings, Councilmember Mendelson. So this is essentially a double in population growth. And when I say planning isn't a popularity contest, the double entendre here is funny. We're talking about population growth. So what are the impacts of that population growth? That is the question. That's what's required by law. Impact assessments of these populations. Do we need more schools, parks, clinics? How about our transportation systems, which WMATA was just threatening to cut? How about our sewers, which are 100 years old? How can the city grow?
Chris, go for it. But my advice to everyone else is to focus on the politics.
Okay, we're gonna go to Chris Williams, also from the steering committee. He wants to speak to this ward level issue.
Thank you, Chairman Mendelson, for joining us. I think it is unfair, fundamentally unfair, that you are saying that your approach, your decisions defer to the ward member, because we have lobbied in Southwest, our ward member, and many other council members, but many watch in indifference as Southwest, in particular, gets more housing, more market housing, and we see really wide demographic shifts in our neighborhood in terms of, and I hope that you have had access to some of the data that we've produced, in terms of who occupies these units. That is a structural issue. So I would like for you, Chairman Mendelson, to acknowledge that when you say, I'm gonna go to your ward member and that ward member has nothing but displacement, Black displacement going on in his district, that is a structural barrier for racial equity. The other structural barrier that I'd like to put on the table is that OP always prioritizes producing more housing, even if that housing is overwhelmingly market housing, despite clear language in our small area plan for preserving our social diversity in our neighborhood. They say, well, the goal, you know, it's always a priority. And so we petition the zoning commission. We are very active politically. You're saying it's a political question. And we could not be more mobilized in Southwest. And our political leadership is simply not listening. And so I would encourage you to reconsider whether going to deferring to the council member where their district has shown vast displacement, vast inequity as the answer. I don't think it's the answer.
I'm not sure I followed all of that. Southwest is diverse, and its diversity is something which Southwest is very proud of and is something that is important. I certainly don't want to see that threatened. Southwest is, when I say diverse, I'm not just talking racially, I'm talking economically as well. And I want to see that preserved, maintained. Now, this isn't, as far as I know, a comprehensive plan issue, but it is a good analogy. A few years ago, when there was the controversy over Shakespeare Theater's proposal at, I think it was 6th and G, the fact of the matter is, whatever view I had was trumped by the council members. And his view is the one that prevailed in the council. So that's why I emphasize that the ward member is important. So, if there are some specific changes that I have to negotiate with Councilmember Allen in this case, I will sit down and talk with him. But in the end, if he and I disagree and he feels strongly, I'm going to have to think about whether I want to go to the mat, which I'm willing to do sometimes. But I can't, I can't disagree on everything that Councilmember Nadeau is proposing in Ward 1 and everything that Councilmember Allen wants to see in Ward 6 and everything that Councilmember, name another Councilmember, wants in their ward. If I do that, I will have no ability to manage the bill. But if you all turn up the pressure on, in this case, Councilmember Allen, he may make some changes to what he wants. It'll be more sensitive to where you are. Now, I say all that theoretically because I don't really know the disagreement that you're having with whatever he's proposing or supporting.
So Okay, we'll leave it at that. And Paul is going to read four questions now that come from the chat and try to.
Great. Thanks, Teresa. So there was a question about CORE, about once CORE sort of does their assessment, find inadequacies in equity and racial equity, then what? What do they have? What powers do they have to halt the plan or to remedy whatever flaws that they find? So that's a CORE question. Then we have a question about the Waterman Hotel, the prospect of converting the hotel to affordable housing, and what's your position on that? And the question, what's your position or when will you appoint to the archives advocacy group? So we'll just do that grouping and then there's a few more.
Okay, you froze a little. So I heard three questions. The first had to do with the CORE racial equity analysis. The racial equity analysis is not binding on the council. The racial equity analysis is to inform not only the council, but the public as to what the CORE believes is the effect of the legislation on racial equity. You might say, well, what's the point if it's not binding? Well, first of all, the only thing that can be binding on the council are votes of the council. But the value in this is that in the process, the iterative process, the committees go through, I mentioned this at the beginning, we'll be going, and my committee is going through working with the CORE staff, we will be making changes to the document. So that's one value in the racial equity analysis. The second is that there will be both public and council discussion with regard to what the conclusions are of the racial equity office. And let me say that the comprehensive plan is a plan. It is not a program. And a program is something that has goals and that has, a program is something that has goals. I'm thinking of, for instance, let me think, our a vaccination program to get vaccines out for the COVID. And so how can we ensure that we overcome any disparities with regard to racial equity? The comprehensive plan is more of a plan. The racial equity analysis is to look, is just that, an analysis. Does the bill, whether we're talking about the plan or another bill, exacerbate inequities? Does it help resolve inequities? That's what it looks at. And then the benefit of that is that there is discussion, awareness, and I'm hopeful, greater sensitivity with regard to what the racial equity impact is. With regard to the question about the Waterman Park, I've not, I don't think I can say at this point, I don't think I can answer that one at this point. I've not focused on what's being proposed for the site. And the third question had to do with the Archives Advocacy Group. As I've answered that person in the past, it's my intent to try to get that done this month.
Okay, there's a few more. Pariza, is that okay?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I had told her 2:45, but I got on 5 minutes late.
Great.
I'll give you till 3, but then I turn into a bumper.
Appreciate your time. So data and demographic trends. There's concern that the data is dated and that the forecasting is uncertain, especially given the pandemic. And a follow-on to that would be with the prospects for statehood, for DC statehood, how would that impact comp plan planning?
The data, I believe the data was updated as of 2019. So while that is a couple of years old, that's certainly better than 2006 data. With regard to statehood, I don't think that immediately affects the plan. Assuming that Congress were to approve statehood legislation this year, that doesn't stop the economic development in the city. And we are expecting in about, I'm gonna say 4 or 5 years that there'll be a new plan.
Okay. If I could just do one more, and I don't know if this was addressed, but just do you have any thoughts on developers circumventing PUD law and the comp plan with the exemptions from IZ Plus and large track review and design review? Do you see that as a circumvention and have any thoughts on that?
I'm not sure I understand the question. Do I see large track
with developers seeking avenues to circumvent community-led development by going around the PUD, by going around the comp plan, by using large track review and design review in IZ Plus? Do you see that as circumventing community-led development in bad faith by developers?
That was my question, and it sought to get at, is the council position to anticipate the ways in which developers are looking to get around whatever language we have, particularly around racial equity? That's in essence the question. And so what we are seeing is that there are efforts to designate projects that have impact as design review. There are efforts in Buzzard Point, for example, to, rather than doing a PUD, they're doing a large track review. We know that with IZ Plus, there were many exemptions built into that law. And so that's the question. How is the council anticipating the ways in which, once this plan is finalized, that they could look to get around it?
Well, developers are always going to look for ways that they can get what they want without any government restriction. That's just one of the laws of physics. The comprehensive plan is binding on zoning. And if a developer goes matter of right, and we've seen some of that in the last couple of years, developers who decided to avoid the risk of appeals, and so they didn't go for planned unit developments, so they went for matter of right, then they can't get around the comprehensive plan, because presumably the zoning reflects the comprehensive plan. But they do get around public participation. It is a little bit counterintuitive, but actually the discretionary review process, like PUDs, is the way to get community participation. Anytime a developer has to go to the zoning commission, then they have to justify whatever they propose in terms of the comprehensive plan. If there are, in the existing zoning, contradictions with the comprehensive plan, then the community, such as through the AMC, can go to the zoning commission to ask for a rezoning to be consistent with the comprehensive plan. I don't think there are very many instances of that. Where we will see this really is with upzoning cases. A large track review process, as I recall, doesn't get around the comprehensive plan, because the large track review process is a process that actually involves the community, not as well as the zoning process, but it does involve the community and the Office of Planning. And it requires the developer to justify the developer's proposal. So it doesn't really circumvent the comprehensive plan. With regard to racial equity, that's a little bit harder to address. Policies such as housing, promoting housing. If one builds an apartment building, that per se doesn't, the building of the apartment building does not in itself per se have the same kind of effect on racial equity as the issue of affordability. So it's not about the structure as much as it is this housing to be built going to be affordable or not? And that's not strictly a zoning issue, but through the planned unit development process, for example, it would be an issue, which is why we're looking to have language in the comprehensive plan speaking to racial equity being important. So what am I trying to say here? Each of these values has different effect depending upon the process. Matter of right has the least input from the community, the least chance to affect equity. The PUD process has the most community process participation and the greatest chance of affecting equity. I would say those are probably the two extremes.
We're going to take one more question. Wanted to invite Evie Washington to unmute and ask her question. Miss Washington was going to speak earlier, but I don't think she was on about the streetcar, and she has a question about that. Miss Washington, are you still there?
Yes, I think I'm unmuted now. Do you hear me?
We hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. Hello, Chairman Mendelson. How are you today?
I'm fine. How are you today?
And I'm not gonna hold you long. I just wanted to know, looking at, we've been in conversations for over 10 years about the streetcar, where it's going and what's gonna happen with it. But now they're talking more about bringing it from Oklahoma Avenue across the bridge on Minnesota Avenue and going down Benning Road, which will affect a lot of the older members of this community who made this community. These people have been living out here for 60 or 70 some years. They're longer this community, but over here. And now if the streetcar goes the way they wanted to go because of noise pollution, and we know that noise pollution causes health issues, these people will be eventually forced to move in that gentrification. And with that comes more rezoning to put in more commercial buildings and stuff. So it seemed like it's inequity for the residents who live over here, and for the, mainly right now our community is changing and you know, it's good, but you know, I don't wanna see all the Blacks moved out of this neighborhood for everyone else to come in here, the same as it is down there pretty much in Southwest. So what can we do? I mean, we have three metro rails, three, Orange Line, Blue Line, Silver Line, run all the way from Virginia, Minnesota Avenue to Benning Road and East Capitol Street and all the way out to Largo, Maryland. We have several bus lines all the way down running the same route, parallel and going the same direction. And we don't need a streetcar going in the same direction, adding more noise pollution. What we need mainly would be something like the circulator buses that will let people off on Benning or Minnesota and go up the hill or around corners within the interior part of the community so they won't have to dodge drug users and drug sellers or worry about their safety trying to get home and walk up hills with children and bags. Most of these people don't have money to take Uber up the hill to their home. We need something like a circulator that will take them from Benning Road to up the hill, say on 40th Street or Blaine Street. So how can we're putting together, when I say we, I mean Fort DuPont Civic Association, putting together some paper and some research to show how this will affect the people who live along these routes and in this community, in which we don't need a streetcar, we need circulator buses. So what advice do you have to us?
Well, I'm not sure what advice I have, Ms. Washington. I have my position has been that I think that the streetcar needs to be extended east to across the river, because it's not satisfactory that it ends in the middle of an intersection at Oklahoma Avenue. I was not happy to hear that the District Department of Transportation believes that completing the streetcar at the Minnesota Avenue Metro is not feasible. I've not looked at their analysis. I'm a little skeptical of that. I think that would make sense. The council member for Ward 7 believes strongly that it should go up Benning to East Capitol. I'm personally not comfortable with that, because that means quite a bit of destruction, if you will, of property on either side of Benning. The ANC for that area, I believe, is opposed to going to East Capitol. I'm not sure that other ANCs agree. So it seems to me a bit of a mess. And I think folks, it would really help if folks in Ward 7 could figure this out. As I said, I think the streetcar should go east of the river, but I don't think it should go up to East Capitol. Now, I don't know if that helps where my thinking is.
Well, I agree with you. I had offered a suggestion to the ANC commissioner and to a council member. If they don't want it to stop there at Oklahoma Avenue, send it over to, the state of Montgomery, or they can come all the way up, since they're going to be redoing the bridge and everything there on Minnesota Avenue and Benning Road. Let it go, streetcar go west, Kenilworth, over into Eastland Gardens, and where Mayfair and all those places are over there. They don't even have good public transportation. They have maybe like one bus. So, and all those people, when in the summertime, you had to sit through like 10 traffic light changes to get out of that area. We don't have to do that where we are. We got buses and subways running all over the place. So give them some relief. Send that bus, turn it, streetcar, and let it go down beside the tracks on Kenilworth, on the west side of Kenilworth, next to Pepco, and then let it connect back on that side with Minnesota or Deanwood Metro. You know, give those people a way to get out, because they're talking about putting a hotel over there. Nobody wants to come to a hotel. You can't get out to go to a meeting or go downtown. You're going to be sitting there for, an hour just trying to get through a traffic light. That's not going to help. So they need that streetcar more than we need it. We don't need it. We got transportation over here, but they do not have anything over there.
I hear you.
A little bit more over there.
I'm going to interrupt now because we are after time. Thank you, Ms. Washington. I appreciate your question. And Chairman, thank you so much for being here with us. To remind us again, what's the date of the markup?
I haven't fixed the date yet.
Okay, I was trying to trick you into telling us, but you didn't fall for it.
Nice try, Bruce.
All right, well, we do appreciate you being here. We appreciate the accessibility. We look forward to continuing to talk with you. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Folks, everybody else, thank you. Everybody else on the line, if you want to just hold on 1 minute, we'll just close out with a couple quick next steps. I know we're over time and we didn't get to everything, but again, please join us every month. We continue these conversations. So here's where we are. We're going to continue to share our housing justice amendments with the council, with supporters as well. We'll generate letters of support for those amendments to the council. Review this racial equity impact assessment as soon as it comes out, as well as the chairman's draft. So upon release, we'll be really reviewing that. We'll send it out to everybody. We may hold an online rally at that point to really lift up what the RIA says and try to get more attention from the council members and the media on those critical issues. we'll send out an action alert at that point with key final changes we need to work on, and then of course participate through the markup process. As the chairman said, depending on how controversial it is, the second vote could be delayed. I don't know how likely, but it could be delayed even into the fall, because if they don't do it before the budget and then they get caught up with the budget, then they get into summer recess. So please go ahead and email the council now, especially if you haven't done it. You can go through Empower DC's website, empowerdc.org/comp plan action. If your organization hasn't signed on to the housing justice priorities, you can do that at this tiny URL, /comp plan cp-sign-on. You can submit a written statement for the record of the oversight hearing for planning and zoning that took place on Thursday. We sent out some talking points, but happy to resend that. The deadline is April 1st. And here's our contact information. Again, if you haven't seen previous, if you weren't at previous meetings and want to check those videos, those are on YouTube. And we have dcgrassrootsplanning.org with more information. So we're going to leave it there since we're over time. Feel free to unmute and say goodbye to each other. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. Enjoy the first day of spring. And we'll see you hopefully next month, if not sooner. Take care, everybody.
Take care, everybody. Bye.
Have a good one.
Bye. We'll send out a follow-up with all the links in case you missed them, okay? Thanks, everybody.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Our folks joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Keep the faith,
baby.
No.
Bye. Continue to give and take care.
Email, Parissa.
Okay, I'll make sure to get that. I got the document. We'll make sure to share it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Take care.
Iris looks like the breath of spring. Wow. You're brightening up my day.
Thank you.
I don't know what we'd all do without each other, I swear.
Okay, we're going to close the recording now, but we'll see everybody next month. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.